This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Mosaic, a daily news program from Link TV, presents a selection of news reports from independent and state-controlled broadcasters from throughout the Middle East.
Yemeni security forces arrested several members of al-Qaeda in the provinces of Imran and Ma'rib. Yemeni authorities launched a campaign against al-Qaeda militants in several provinces. Meanwhile, the U.S. and Britain reopened their embassies in Sana'a after 3 days of closure due to terrorist threats.
قوات الأمن اليمنية تشن حملة شعواء على تنظيم القاعدة وخلافها.
Yemeni security forces stepped up their campaign against al-Qaeda and its cells, spreading across the Yemeni territory. Sana'a said that its security forces are determined to break the willpower of al-Qaeda and limit its activities that have caused concern among the military institution and caused a negative shadow on the country's internal affairs. The Yemeni authorities announced the arrests of 3 al-Qaeda suspects who were admitted to the Raida hospital in the province of Imran due to injuries they sustained during clashes with the security forces in the region of Arhab. In addition, Yemeni forces arrested 4 people accused of collaborating with al-Qaeda militants in Arhab. The security agencies also arrested 2 members of al-Qaeda from the Ma'rib tribes. The Yemeni Ministry of Interior said its security forces are engaging in an all-out war with al-Qaeda and that it's seeking to reassure Western embassies and installations in Yemen. The Yemeni security agencies continue to mount pressure on some of the local tribes accused of aiding and harboring al-Qaeda militants in the province of Atraf. On the other hand, a Yemeni military command center said that some tribal leaders are cooperating with the security forces in the war against al-Qaeda. The tribal leaders helped in the pursuit of al-Qaeda militants and denied them shelter. Yemeni authorities deployed thousands of soldiers from the special tactic and counter-terrorism forces in the provinces of Shabwa, Baida, and Abyan in a stepped-up campaign against al-Qaeda. Meanwhile, the U.S. and British embassies reopened after 3 days of closure due to terrorist threats.
بسبب المخاوف من تهديدات إرهابية.
U.S. Special Forces, backed by drones, continued to carry out surveillance and support missions to help the Yemeni forces in their war on al-Qaeda. This news comes after al-Qaeda targeted U.S. installations in Yemen.
The U.S. is relying on Yemeni Special Forces to pursue al-Qaeda activities in the country. According to Brigadier General Yahya Abdullah Saleh, the Yemeni Special Forces are firm, professional, and combative.
We will do everything in our power to fight al-Qaeda.
Al-Qaeda used its presence in Yemen to attack U.S. installations in October 2000, when a suicide bomber blew up the USS Cole in the port of Aden. Following the USS Cole bombing and with the help of the U.S., the Yemeni government took measures to counter al-Qaeda. Today, Yemen is once again receiving Washington support.
Every time things go bad, we receive more support.
The U.S. Special Forces, backed by drones, continue to carry out surveillance operations in Yemen. Washington has provided Yemeni forces with cruise missiles, which were used in the attack on the al-Qaeda base, nearly 20 miles away from the Yemeni capital of Sana'a. The relatives of several suspected militants were killed in the attack. U.S. military officials said that their operation is not a display of power, but rather a preparation for a fierce battle that could last years. منى دياباتي العربية.
The events that took place on Christmas Day forced the American administration to reconsider many of its positions. President Barack Obama renewed his promise to close down Guantanamo Bay Prison, despite the delay caused by the U.S. decision to suspend returning Yemeni prisoners to their country following the failed attack on an American plane on the 25th of December. Obama said the decision to close down Guantanamo and transfer the prisoners to other countries was taken to protect the U.S. Emil Baroudi reports from Washington.
أكد الرئيس الأمريكي باراك أوباما بعد اجتماع ضم في البيت الأبيض
American President Barack Obama met with his national security team in the White House and demanded that they take a series of measures to improve security in American airports in order to avoid a repeat of the incident that took place on the plane flying from Amsterdam to Detroit on Christmas Day. These security measures include additional searches for nationals from 13 Arab and Muslim countries and for all passengers who transit in these countries.
As of yesterday, the Transportation Security Administration, or TSA, is requiring enhanced screening for passengers flying into the United States from or flying through nations on our list of state sponsors of terrorism or other countries of interest.
The reaction to these additional security measures were mixed. Some people expressed concern that there will be security lapses, while others expressed concern that these measures will be followed by yet additional measures.
Now, the public may look at Lebanese nationals, for example, and say, well, if the government views them with suspicion, then we too have to be careful around them. We fear that this will lead to discriminatory practices outside the airport.
There are concerns that the new security measures will affect American businesses in the Middle East as well as political relations.
Today's security measures were legislated by the American government. They do not focus on relations with certain countries. Rather, as President Obama stated, the measures are taken to protect American security and in order for U.S. to work in coordination with these countries in the future.
President Barack Obama did not say more than what was published in newspapers in recent days. However, Obama used the opportunity to express his anger towards the intelligence apparatus in the U.S. for failing to catch the Nigerian who carried the bomb onto the plane. Perhaps he is paving the way for replacing the head of one of the intelligence agencies. Dozens of activists from the Artery of Life convoy destined to Gaza violently clashed with Egyptian security forces, causing many injuries near the Egyptian area of Al-Arish.
The situation escalated when the Egyptians prevented about 50 vehicles from the convoy to enter the Rafah crossing.
Our reporter Yasser Abu Hilala in Al-Arish.
They were no longer able to stay in the Egyptian port of Al-Arish, so they went outside and held a sit-in. They considered themselves prisoners because they were prevented from driving about one-fifth of the Artery of Life vehicles into Gaza after having driven them thousands of miles. They were not allowed to enter Gaza, which was only a few blocks away from them, and clashed with the Egyptian security forces. They fiercely responded to the attacks by the Egyptian security and held three security officers against their will. About 40 of them sustained different injuries. Six American, British, Kuwaiti, and Malaysian nationals were arrested. The Egyptian authorities accused them of taking over the port. They said that they did not prevent the arrival of humanitarian aid to Gaza and that they only prevented private cars that are not used for humanitarian purposes from entering Gaza. The activists, however, said that they were held in the port and that the humanitarian aid convoy cannot be divided. They say that breaking the siege in Gaza is both a political and humanitarian mission. Jana, who is only 16 years old, is the youngest convoy participant. She came from Ohio, but she too was not spared from the beatings.
We have 70 and 80-year-old people, but they were beaten by the Egyptian security forces. They also came and took a man named Sharif and put him in a truck and started beating him. They were asking him about his passport, but he said that he has no passport. They were beating him anyway. They pushed me away from the truck, took the stick from me, and hit me on my back.
The diplomatic mediation efforts led by the Turks were intensified and the clashes calmed down.
We in Turkey believe that Gaza and the Palestinian people are one nation. There has always been strong relations between the Palestinian and Turkish people, and they became even stronger during the government of Erdogan.
The international activists came to break the Israeli-imposed siege on Gaza, only to find themselves under siege. They have been driving the artery of live convoy vehicles for more than 1 month, and they hope that their trip will end soon. The activists have crossed thousands of miles in the hopes that the humanitarian supplies they carry would help the Palestinians endure the suffering caused by the Israeli war machine. Now, they are forced to use the medical supplies to treat their own injuries.
German mediator arrived in Gaza today to receive the Hamas response to Israel's latest offer in the prisoner exchange deal that would bring Gilad Shalit home. Trade and Industry Minister Benjamin Ben-Eliezer said today he is optimistic about the chances for a swap. On the other hand, Hamas deputy political chief Musa Abu Marzouk said despite the unprecedented efforts of the German mediator and the progress made, these are not enough to complete the prisoner exchange. He charged that Israel had reneged on previous agreements regarding the deal. In other news today, Jerusalem's Planning and Construction Committee has decided to authorize the construction of a new Jewish neighborhood in the East Jerusalem area close to Beit Orot Yeshiva. According to the plan, four residential buildings are to be constructed on the site to accommodate 24 Jewish families. The land on which the new neighborhood will be built is private property, and therefore the construction is not subject to permission from the government. A statement from the municipality said, "This is a professional planning decision by the local planning and construction committee and does not determine whether the units will be inhabited by Jews or Arabs." The man behind the project is American millionaire Irving Moskowitz, who is considered the primary sponsor of Jewish building in eastern Jerusalem, mainly in the City of David and in the Ras Al Amud project on the Mount of Olives. A new highway that will connect the northern Jerusalem neighborhood of Pisgat Ze'ev with Highway 443 has drawn protest from left-wingers. Officials at Peace Now have slammed the plan for the new road known as Route 20, which they say will be built on privately owned Palestinian land that is to be appropriated for a road that will cater solely to Israeli motorists. Less than a week after Israel's high court ordered the state to lift its ban on Palestinian motorists driving on Highway 443, planning officials are laying the groundwork for Highway 20. Peace Now, which submitted an official complaint to the Transportation Ministry's Planning Committee, says that the highway will usurp land in the adjacent village of Beit Hanina. The government sees Highway 20 as a way to ease the traffic problems that have plagued the French Hill section of Jerusalem. A spokesman said the new road will be open to both Arabs and Jews.
ونعود بكم مشاهدينا الكرام إلى مثل هذه الأيام من العام.
On this day last year, Israeli occupation forces destroyed the government building complex that housed a number of ministries and offices in the Talat Islam area in western Gaza. Joining us directly from the complex is our correspondent Abdullah Murtaja. Abdullah, please describe the area to us a year after it was targeted, which is where our government began its work.
نعم هنا وفي هذا المكان بالتحديد تجر إشارة إلى شيء مهم جدا وهو أنه
A very important thing worth pointing out here is that in this very place, shown by our camera, lay the ruins that speak volumes of the degree of the Zionist crime. We're in an area in western Gaza, which is on the opposite end of eastern Gaza, where we find Zionist tanks storming around, blowing up buildings, destroying trees, and raiding homes. Here in western Gaza, things seem to be even worse. Nothing can hide from the Zionist warplanes. We see here the ruins of the destroyed buildings. They are so damaged that they may be impossible to reconstruct unless we completely demolish and rebuild again, as a number of engineers told us. As you can see in the background, this building that we're seeing now used to be the headquarters of the Palestinian Foreign Ministry, and it's the western building. The middle building, or building 2, used to be the office of the Ministry of Finance. And the eastern building, or building 3, used to house the Ministries of Social Affairs and Housing. According to the construction contract, each building here in this complex cost about $1.5 million. The construction of these buildings began in 2000 and completed in 2004. The fruit of 4 years of construction was destroyed in just 4 seconds by the occupation forces and turned into rubble just as you see here today. Each building consisted of 7 floors above the ground, in addition to basement levels 1 and 2, making it a 9-story building. The first floor was about 1,000 square meters. Each of these 3 buildings could hold 500 people and employees. A number of ministries and government institutions that moved here in 2004 began to officially work here in late 2004. Now the damage done to this building may have caused more problems besides the rubble that we see. A specific problem for the Palestinian government is that all the buildings have been damaged, including the departments of art and labor that citizens used to access easily. So the major problem for the Palestinian government may be the lack of a place to gather the ministers, provide assistance to citizens, and process their official procedures such as employment and retirement. The building of the foreign ministry in particular was severely damaged and cut off Palestine's connection to the outside.
Orthodox Christians celebrate Christmas in the city of Bethlehem. Greek patriarch Theophilos III arrived in the West Bank town, revered as the birthplace of Jesus, to lead celebrations for the Greek Orthodox Christmas. But the ceremony was marred by a land row, as Palestinian Christian groups are boycotting the celebrations, accusing the church of selling or leasing land to Israelis. The Council for Arab Orthodox Institutions and Organizations in Palestine said the current patriarch, Theophilos III, had continued to allow Israeli investors to lease church land in the West Bank and East Jerusalem. Through Israel's army eased restrictions to allow visitors into the town, the barrier remained an obstacle for many Christians living in the West Bank and Gaza Strip. The patriarch was greeted by various clergy and Palestinian officials at the entrance to the church ahead of traditional midnight mass. Patriarch Irenaeus was ousted in 2005 over alleged involvement in the leasing of church land in occupied Jerusalem to Jewish investors.
رغم انتهاء عام 2009 الا ان
2009 has passed, but many problems facing Iraqis are still not solved. The most important of these are the problems facing orphans and widows, but Iraqi officials are still ignoring these problems.
بمنتهى التجاهل والاهمال.
الارامل والايتام شريحه كبيره.
The widows and orphans comprise a large segment of the Iraqi population. Although it has been ongoing for a long time, it is still not resolved. The wars that Iraq went through in the last 2 decades and the American invasion have widowed many women and orphaned many children. They continue to suffer and their problem has still not been resolved. Many questions are being raised about the role of the government in dealing with this complicated problem. A large number of orphans left their schools and were forced to find jobs and support their families.
My 7 children are orphans. Our life conditions are difficult. We are suffering from the hard economic conditions.
I'm a widow. My husband was killed in a terrorist attack. Wherever I go to ask for help, they tell me to go elsewhere. I went to the Prime Minister's office and to the Governor of Baghdad. I applied for everything, but I was declined. They are only willing to give me the retirement salary. Where can I go? I'm living with my very big family.
According to the websites of international organizations, the number of Iraqi widows exceeds 1 million. Iraq has more than 5 million orphans, which entitles it to enter the Guinness World Records for the number of orphans and widows. The Iraqi government must take a serious position and reconsider their serious social problems. It must find ways to help the orphans deal with their difficult living conditions. This segment of the Iraqi population does not have tangible support and suffers from the high cost of living.
The widows and orphans continue to suffer today because the government continues to ignore them and does not help them. Iraqi widows depend on charity. The government doesn't care about orphans and widows. Most of the widows and orphans were displaced from their homes. They are suffering from a lack of shelter and the high cost of living, which are two difficult problems. The government ignores these two problems. It never pays attention to these issues.
It is worth mentioning that the labor and social ministries must put in place a program to help widows find jobs. What the ministry is doing so far is not sufficient to solve the problem. The current laws only benefit a small number of families. As 2009 ends, it seems that the Iraqi government has failed to improve the living conditions of the widows and orphans and stop their suffering. The widows still hope for a better future, even if it takes many years. Ahmad Saeed, Baghdad Satellite Channel, Baghdad.
Many Iraqis started to use boats to travel between Kark and Rusafa in Baghdad. This news comes as more streets in the Iraqi capital are increasingly witnessing traffic gridlocks. This is due to the large increase in the number of imported cars in Iraq after 2003.
Hajj Hussein has spent the last 40 years of his life working on the banks of the Tigris River. He used his boat for fishing or as a vehicle to transport goods and travelers across the Tigris. This is his way of earning an income. His business has recently witnessed a boost as more travelers started to use boats to avoid heavy traffic on the streets of Baghdad.
Before 2003, many did not know about this route in the area of Bab Sweif. Now, with more gridlocks witnessed in the streets of the Iraqi capital, many commuters have started to use boats to cross to the other side of the river.
Nearly 1.5 million cars are crowding the streets of the Iraqi capital, with many being imported after 2003. That number is beyond the capacity of the Iraqi capital. The import of cars took place mainly in the aftermath of the 2003 United States occupation of Iraq. It was carried out randomly and without a legal mechanism to help organize it. Iraqi roads are frequently cut off or closed due to bomb attacks and due to the heavy presence of security checkpoints, which stands at 1,800. This has caused major gridlocks on the streets of Iraq, especially in and around the Iraqi capital.
We need to build and open new roads, especially highways. We must build new freeways that are not connected to intersections. This will help citizens travel fast and without the inconvenience of stopping at intersections.
The frequent closure of major roadways and bridges due to the security breaches has led Ali and many others to travel via boats across the Tigris River.
Why is the government lagging behind in this issue? The area is witnessing relative stability. The bombings and the security checkpoints are impeding travel in Baghdad. The government should look for alternatives. I understand that they need to deploy police along the river, but they must keep it open for the commuters.
The security measures are impeding the flow of traffic across the river in central Baghdad. The mobility of boats is restricted to certain areas that are located between two or three bridges from a total of 11 bridges along the Tigris River. To the right of the boat, you can see the green zone that houses the headquarters of the Iraqi government and the United States forces. Boats are warned to keep their distance from the green zone. To your left, there are military and security bases which are closed to boats. And in between, boats are allowed to pass. From Baghdad, Khodr Shaheen, BBC.
France's opposition socialist party has objected to calls for a legal ban on a full Islamic veil. The announcement comes after President Nicolas Sarkozy raised the prospect of a non-binding parliamentary resolution against the burqa. Many politicians have warned that such a law would be difficult to enforce and it could face a challenge in the European Rights Court. A parliament report on the issue is expected at the end of this month.
Last, I've rocked Afghanistan, killing at least 18 civilians and injuring 9 NATO service members. A market explosion in the southeastern Khost province killed 13 civilians. Health officials say at least another 13 people were also wounded, some of them critically. Another blast in the eastern city of Jalalabad killed 3 people and wounded more than 40 others. Earlier, a bomb blast in the eastern Nangarhar province ripped through a NATO convoy, killing 2 Afghans reported to be children. 9 NATO service members and 4 Afghan policemen and many civilians were injured in the incident. Attacks on NATO troops have been on the rise across Afghanistan, with last year marking the deadliest since the U.S.-led invasion in 2001.
Get more news about the Middle East online at linktv.org/mosaic. The Mosaic webpage offers a complete archive of Mosaic programs, program transcripts, the Mosaic video podcast, and the Mosaic Intelligence Report, a weekly analysis of the hottest stories from the Middle East. The views expressed on Mosaic are those of the participating broadcasters, not Link TV or its sponsors. The production of Mosaic is made possible with the support of viewers like you. Thank you.
This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Link TV is the only U.S. network dedicated to global and national news, uncompromising documentaries, and diverse cultural programs, programs which connect you to the world.